Congratulations. By choosing the cutting-edge home video cassette, you've joined the small but growing elite of video connoisseurs. You know, we've made a vast impact on the public awareness, and we feel that most of you have acquired this tape, fully realizing the type of high-quality excitement that you're in for. But perhaps there might be still a few among you that have chosen this tape by accident, mistaking it for yet another mad slasher movie. We'll try to clear up that confusion. Sit back and enjoy the next commercial-free 60 minutes, and let us show you exactly what the cutting edge is all about.
Cutting Edge, Volume 1, with your host, Peter Zaremba.
We're really lucky tonight, because we have Jonathan Richman and his modern lovers on our show. First question they've asked me is, do I like rock videos? Not on your life. What would make a good rock video? Feeling.
Hello, everyone. Jonathan Richman and the Modern Lovers here. We're gonna do something called Corner Store. A one, a two, one. I walked past just yesterday, and I could not bear that new mall anymore. I don't expect everyone to see it my way, but they don't know the trees that were there before. And I want them to put back that corner store. I walk past just like I say, and I felt the hurt that would not go home. I don't expect everyone to see it my way, but they don't know the trees I've known. And I want them to put back that cornerstone.
I would like to say that shows are always fun, but that is not true. Sometimes I don't like the way a lot of the people in my audiences are taking my songs. And you know why? It's because they don't have enough, I wouldn't say they don't have enough feeling, but they're just trying to hide their feeling, and that's a dead audience. And so they nervously laugh. I'm the kind of performer who, when people first see the show, a lot of times they laugh like, because they're looking to see, before they applaud, they're looking to see what the other folks are going to do and whether it's cool to applaud. And when I have an audience full of people like that, no, shows aren't always fun. So in order for me to have fun, I always like playing with the band on stage, but for me to really have a good time, people can't be afraid to let their feelings show.
I walked past one last time, but I wished the worst on the place I shot. I don't expect everyone to feel it like I'm, but I spot a trend that has got to stop, and I want them to put back that cornerstone.
They would like to ask how I write songs. Take Cruddy Little Chewing Gum Wrapper. There was actually Cruddy Little Chewing Gum Wrapper right there on the park. And how's the song goes? Cruddy Little Chewing Gum Wrapper that I saw on a walk. I saw the faded green, which was true, was faded green, and I could hardly talk. I was just hypnotized. Cruddy Little Chewing Gum Wrapper, my heart would not let go. It was caught by the colors that my eyes like, so it was simply true. And I love the little colors, that's true, like what end up at the dump, and they do. My heart go bumpity, 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 bump. So that's why it's easy for me to write songs, because I just make up stuff that already happened.
Now my jeans, they are afraid, but don't cause I tried. My hips, they had no room to play in, and my little bum felt all trapped inside them. There's Levi's all around. If they had Wranglers, I would know. I've turned the whole store upside down, and they don't got Wranglers. So let's go. My jeans, they are free. Oh, my jeans, they are free. Very bad.
Why not Levi's? Why not?
To fit me, no matter what the size.
Why not Levi's? Why not Levi's?
Look, the bum doesn't fit, nor the hips, nor the thighs.
My jeans,
they are frayed. Oh,
my jeans,
they are frayed. Very bad. Last verse.
I'm the kind of entertainer that I hear the word naive and innocent written. Well, there's nothing really that naive about me. I know that we're bombing the hell out of Latin America right now, maybe not our own people, but the United States is certainly helping. I don't pretend to be naive. I know other things that are going on, things that are going on in the music industry. I'm naive about some things. For example, I'm naive about how many drugs most people take. It still staggers me. You mean that person was on it too? You mean that person I was just talking to? But you wouldn't call me naive. You wouldn't call my songs, I read things like attempts to be very simple, well, simple enough so that they can be remembered easily. But no, I'm not understood that well by the press, I think because they try and complicate it too much. All you gotta do with this stuff, folks, is like it or not like it.
Well, they're all in my trance. When I dance, Jonathan, why do you think so? Well, when I dance, that's action. Sometimes I cause this attraction, you know, that I don't really try to stop. I just certainly don't try to stop it. And no. I don't blush because I like it like that. I'm not a pro. I'm not a pro. In fact, I barely even move compared to certain guys, you know. And if the music isn't right that day, then my little body didn't hardly has anything to say. But they're all in my trance. Well, I dance, oh yeah, the way I move myself around. But they're all in my trance. Well,
do you have a moment? Hi, we're doing a TV show, and the term the cutting edge is being like used a lot lately, and I was wondering if you had any ideas about like maybe what that means.
What the cutting edge
means? Yeah, what does it mean? What do you feel about it?
To tell you the truth, I haven't heard that expression lately.
At
as
all?
You're saying. No, I haven't. I have no idea.
Really?
Cutting edge.
Well, what does it bring to your mind?
No idea.
What do you think it means?
This is crazy, dude. It's like an acid trip or something.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm Dave Faulkner, and I play guitar and sing for the Hoodoo Gurus.
Hi, my name's Mark Kingswell, and I hit these things for the Hoodoo Gurus.
Hi, Groovers, I'm Brad Shepherd, and I play guitar for the Gurus.
Do you know where my strings went to?
Hi, I'm Clyde Bramley, and I play bass guitar for the Hoodoo Gurus.
Well, if you want to know why we have such old guitars, number one is because we can't afford new ones for a start. But the best thing about it is that you can do this.
Just begun, and I'm cruising.
Sure, there's a lot of American culture in Australia. McDonald's is everywhere, and
sure.
We don't have Burger King. They have a different name there because someone else copyrighted it. But things like that, you know, I mean, all the music is really international, really. What is probably more interesting is what is Australian about Australia, and that's something that's not so easy to explain because it comes, I guess, from the way the country developed in isolation and with the convicts and so forth. There's a certain disrespect for authority. You know, we never really had the sort of the dream family sort of image presented as part of Australiana. It was more like the guy who sort of, you know, threw a stone at the policeman is more of a hero than the guy who sort of, you know, helped him to direct traffic.
I will burn!
Lucille Ball hasn't personally contributed anything to the album itself, but a lot to my life. It's one of my favorite programs is I Love Lucy. Here's Lucy's okay, you know, but I Love Lucy's a classic. And we're all big fans of television shows from many different, you know, ages. And she's just one of my heroes, and so I got to put her name on the cover. I mean, I think I wanted to put Phyllis Diller on. I don't know if she's there or not. She's on there, great. I was called compared to Phyllis Diller the last time I was in LA, where my hair was all teased up. So I was pretty pleased with that, actually. Even though the person thought they were criticizing me. I thought it was great.
I kiss the ground on which you walk. I kiss the lips through which you talk. I kiss the city out of me. You're my darling, don't forget it. Cause I'm the guy who will regret it. I love you more than when I see.
We play a fairly universal kind of music, so it doesn't matter whether we come from Australia, England or America. Just our accents are a bit different, that's all.
Different people to give us their personal New Year's resolutions and predictions. Now, some people just joke around and others are very serious. One group of people that's always very serious are the Alarm. In fact, they're serious about being serious. So here, in response to your numerous requests, are the Alarm.
Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna bring someone on the stage. And he's going to take some pictures so we can all be on the telly and our dreams can all come true, eh? We all want to be on the telly, don't we? Can we have the house lights up, Bobby Blue? Film that, look at it. Up on the terrace, can I hear the crowd roar? Shit!
We started in the most competitive business that the world's ever invented, where there's millions and millions of people trying to do exactly what I'm doing. And we started off in one of the most competitive cities in the world, in London. We'd play concerts, five bands a night. And we had to look better than every group. We had to sound better than every group. We had to say better things off the stage. We had to be more articulate in interviews. We had to look better on TV, you know. And so I'd get up on stage, and we had to be very aggressive because we had to kind of bang our message home.
I think going to the Alarm would take away more than just a ticket stub from a gig, but a firm memory of thinking,
that was a really special show on many different levels. And then many performers tend to forget that they think, oh, I've written a song and that is it. I don't, you know, if people want to come in, fine. If people want to do this one, blah, blah, blah. But we, as a group, try and reach people on many, many different levels. We really think very carefully about everything we do. Feeling creating on stage, and what you try and do is you try and get the audience to feel the same things just by playing to them, just by maybe it's a smile, you know, maybe it's a, you know, a few words, but in the end, when you get all those people to understand what you're going through, then it's one incredible feeling.
We've had a lot of run-ins with the press because whenever I've sat down with a conversation with a journalist, I've done it and just talked about what's happening. And I've tried to treat them like human beings and have a conversation. And if I've said something, so I often expect a response back. Because sometimes I say things that I'm wrong to say, really. And I'd like it if journalists would say to me, "I think you're wrong there, Mike." Then I could learn something. But what has happened in the past, I've said my things and just thought, all right, you know, and written it all down and thought, I'll get this guy. A lot of people said, you can't say that. It's, you know, it's not right. You just can't say things like that. And we just, in a way, we just looked at people and looked straight in their eyes and said, I'm saying it because I feel that way. And I'm sure that other people out there feel the same way as I do.
People, light up your night tonight. I wanna see you shine. Fight this battle. Don't let it get you down. Don't let it tie you down. There's a man with a wife and two children who's been told you can't work. There's a boy who's been told there's no future. He's been fed by the blind. And I can hear them crying as they try to sleep through the night. I can hear them cry.
People said, stop writing we, man. Stop doing this, you know, and they said, we want to know about you. And the band, they freed me, they agreed with our, they freed me from the responsibility of writing from the Alarm's point of view. They said, write from your own point of view, man. And so I went away and wrote a lot of songs about me and my life and where I'd come from and what I'd seen. And I think that's made our music a lot more powerful in the long run. I think it's also made our stage performances a lot more powerful.
We've grown up and it feels good to be out here playing a new set of songs and playing with a different attitude. It's very rewarding.
I'm not one of those tongue-clucking grammarians who leap on split infinitives or misplace modifiers like a mongoose on a cobra. I'm not even much of a reader. I skim magazines, stopping now and then to sneer at some scorn-worthy nugget. I'll force a few pages of Joan Didion or Norman Mailer into my brain before I get fed up and throw the book across the room. I'll even read the New York Review of Books from time to time to see what new 12-volume biography of Vita Sackville West has been unleashed in a panting and eager reading public. I used to think that bleeding-heart mourners of literacy were beneath my contempt, and believe me, my contempt will stoop to anything. Those who say nobody reads anymore usually mean nobody reads me. Boo-hoo, and what is there to read anyway? One more self-conscious novel about a novelist trying to write a novel. One more New Yorker short story about a divorcee and her Irish setter frolicking along a New England beach. A novelization. Any jerk who reads a paperback version of a movie deserves professional help, not our pity. Now I can handle reading t-shirts. Kiss me, I'm Polish. My folks went to Disneyland. All they bought me was this lousy t-shirt. The obscene message to Gaddafi that Gaddafi will never see, but the jerk's wearing the t-shirt anyway. I can handle bumper stickers. If you don't like the way I drive, stay off the sidewalk. Honk if you love Jesus. Honk if you are Jesus. I can handle all this. If you want to plaster unfunny used jokes on a moving vehicle or display your half-baked beliefs on your body, that's your business. After all, t-shirts and bumper stickers are the prose form of the 80s, but I gotta draw the line here, folks. This heart business has got me in a cold sweat. You know what I'm talking about. I heart LA, I heart NY, I heart SF, I heart my dog head. It's got me buffaloed. What is being said? You love New York, so what? You love your dog. Who cares? Are you afraid people would think you didn't love your dog if you didn't have the heart your dog head bumper sticker? Did you hate your dog before you got the heart your dog head bumper sticker? Now you love the mangy beast? Why do you want to share this information with the car behind you? Do you even have a damn dog? Maybe it's just wishful thinking. If you do have a dog, and if you love the mangy cur, why don't you roll down the window and shout, I love my dog. At least there'd be some passion. Not this dim-witted graphic equivalent of baby talk. So cute it's creepy shorthand designed for Neanderthals or not too bright three-year-olds. Write it out. Shut it up, but throw those damn hearts away. Get it off your bumper and back on your sleeve. I gotta go.
A few years back, I joined a swim team. It's made a considerable amount of difference in my life. And this is my tribute to all the girls on the team. By the pool, quite a few live in Malibu. They got their sandwiches in their igloo cooler. The guys are laying out, they're pretty buff dudes. I'm working on my tattoo. I always introduce myself at the beginning of a show as your basic average all-American Jewish lesbian folk singer, and that always gets a laugh. So I think it makes the fact that I'm a lesbian a little bit more, I don't know, it kind of takes the edge off. When I come on stage and people see my image, a lot of times they really don't know what I am. A lot of times they think I'm a man, or they just really can't figure it out. They have a lot of trouble. And so I feel it's real important that I introduce myself as a Jewish lesbian folk singer. And people always laugh when I introduce myself, and I feel that the laughter is probably just a lot of release of tension. But once I get through that, you know, and I usually introduce myself like that after the first song, the whole audience just opens up. It's like getting through, it just breaks right through the barrier.
Every day we get up at 5, jump in the pool, practice our butterfly, swimming till we're dead then. Run to the showers, shampoo each other's hair. Jen, Jenny, Donna, Pam, and Debbie. Are some of the girls.
I was in nervous gender and Catholic discipline, and throughout like 78, 79, in that when LA was like the real happening scene. And then I started playing acoustically mainly because I wrote the song called Take Off Your Swastikas, which I wrote because everywhere I went, people were wearing swastikas, and I'm Jewish, and it bothered me quite a bit. And I was frustrated that I couldn't hear a lot of the words that people were saying, and so that was my main reason why I returned back to like a folk format. Plus, folk music has always been my very favorite. I grew up listening to old Pete Seeger records, and so it's a major influence, and it's also my favorite stuff, so I decided to like go back and do some of that.
I've always been one of the dudes with my flat top and my combat boots. Now I'm learning all the thrills that come with wearing espadrilles. Jen, Jenny, Donna, Pam, and Debbie. They're trying to get me to shave my legs.
message has always been important. In punk rock, the lyrics are very important. I was just frustrated that I couldn't hear them a lot of the times, you know, because punk rock is a real basic form of folk music of the 80s, you know. It's carrying the message to the people. It's saying what's going on. It's protest music. It's talking about what's happening. But I think you can hear the words now, God, almost better than ever.
Well, recently, friends have been departing, a permanent blame, but not me. I plan to stick around, you see, cause I'm a life, a lover, that's me. Yes, recently, friends have been departing, a permanent blame, but not me. I plan to stick around, you see, cause I'm a life, a lover, that's me. Now, I'm real lucky. All my parts work. My eyes, my nose, my hands, my fingers, my legs and my toes. And that makes me love life. Oh, yes, it does.
I teach swimming, my other job. And so I'd go and I'd teach swimming and I'd save up my money. And then I'd go into the studio and record a few songs. And then I'd, you know, be teaching swimming all the way along here. And save up my money and go in and record a few songs. And I made my record. And most of the record is a two-track record, just me and the guitar. There are two songs, but one song really that has a little bit of production on it. But basically, it's just me. I made the record very cheaply for about $1,500, all by myself.
No, it hasn't always been easy, folks. Nope. Sometimes I get real depressed, too. Hey, but if I can do it, then every single one of you can do it, too. Because recently, friends have been departing, a permanent plea, but not me. I plan to stick around, you see, because I'm a life, a lover, that's me. Oh, yeah, I'm a life, a lover, that's me. Uh-huh, Frank's a life, a lover, that's me. Oh, yeah, I'm a life, a lover, that's me. Stick around.
We're discussing the boredom crisis. What things bore you?
An administration that won't listen to students. A U.S. administration that lies to its people. And the kind of economic imperialism this country has, what its people don't know about. And I think that causes boredom and apathy.
What do you do to keep from being bored?
Skate, study, surf.
I recommend reading and working and contemplating. You must think, for thinking is the essence of the human being's existence. Otherwise, you're just a stick.
To it, what garage rock is just like, it's like everything that you listen to is incorporated into like one sound, which becomes your own sound. That's what garage rock really is. I mean, it's not like you have to go out of your way to become a garage band by trying to sound like a garage band. It should happen naturally.
I mean, you can be a funky garage band, or a, you know, as long as you have that homemade thing. Like Archie Bell and the Drell sound, they were funk, but they sounded garagey, even though they might not have had a garage. You know? They might have had a basement or something. We technically were a basement band, because our first 3 or 4 years were spent in basements.
Now remember, this is important too. Whenever you're dealing with food, look, your hands should be clean.
Absolutely.
Even the swankest restaurants get citations, okay?
Absolutely.
That's the type of advertisement you don't want.
Right.
Flesh Tone albums should be as frequent as, like, I don't know, changing the seasons or something. There should be so many Flesh Tone albums that people just won't know what to do, you know? So far, we've such a scant supply. I think then, like, with each one, we get more emphatic. I think we get a little bit more harder. We get a little more edgy, a little more irritating.
Straight up skull, out of the blue.
a really good show for myself. Sometimes people say it picks up like a religious edge, you know, slightly, you know, it's like what, I mean, we don't know what we're doing, but we're doing something, you know.
You got your face.
Okay, right, relay on the buns.
Okay, here come the buns.
Relay on the buns. Yeah. Line up.
I tried to go and do something I've never done before, you know, and to do, like, not to be afraid of anything, you know. I'm totally not afraid to jump anywhere, to do anything, to ask anyone to do something, you know. I guess I'm just trying to make up for, like, the first 20 years of my life when I was always embarrassed and, you know, had no friends. So, you know what I mean? Like, I don't, it's like when on stage, I don't want to have to ever be embarrassed again, you know? And I don't want anyone in the audience to ever have to be embarrassed again about anything.
Most garage rock always seemed like it was, you know, it's like heavy hook music, you know? And not too much on the virtuosity, please.
Delicious.
This burger.
I do think we made them ourselves.
The cutting edge is in music, that which can make you almost want to cry. It's reached that cutting edge. It's that good. But you see,
it's gone that far.
It's gone that far into them. And I heard that explained one other time. And you just feel it. That's for why some certain people like Paul Anka or Tony Bennett or any of those, you know, or Wayne Newton or any of them. I mean, they have a certain something, but they know how to bring you to that point, and you don't mind going so high with it.
And I present to you with great pride, ladies and gentlemen, people of New Orleans and home, the DVs.
I love what I do, and I love what the band does, and I would never change a thing. I just love to jump around, you know. I get out there on stage and I feel like very comfortable, probably more comfortable than I do in conversation with people.
If you believe that love is a sure thing, you said, lower, I hit the ceiling. Do you believe?
I just think it's really good that there's people writing really good songs now for this generation of people. There's really great bands like Husker Du and The Replacements and Elvis Costello, and they sort of serve the same purpose as Cole Porter did for somebody's parents, or Elvis Presley did for somebody's parents. And it's a good thing to have. It makes radio seem valid still. It makes music seem valid, especially in light of what you have to do for videos these days. The tune is still the most important thing, the melody.
When happy is just a state of mind, that you were supposed to leave behind. And when your world has crumbled fast, and solitude is left at last.
We started playing in Mardi Gras last year. Our manager's from New Orleans and knows a lot of people down here. We played at the World's Fair here also a couple of years ago. And we just decided that we enjoyed it so much that we would come down every year that we could. And this year we're playing with a whole bunch of bands, and we're going to try to make it an annual event.
Most of you remember Sarah Romweber, former drummer of Let's Active. Now Sarah lives with her family in Carrboro, North Carolina. Romweber's are pretty well known around here. Her brother, Joe, is lead singer in UV Prom. Her sister, Monica, a rock and roll devotee. And then there's little brother Dexter, who moved his bedroom into a building behind the house. He calls it the mausoleum. Dexter is no poser. He loves American rock and roll and lives it 24 hours a day. I really don't know what else to tell you about Dexter. He's the kind of kid that would take a long time to get to know.
Welcome to the Moss. This is where I spend my time. It's where I spend my time growing up.
And drinking beer.
That ain't true. I'll give you a brief tour of the place. It's not really that, you know, people think it's a big deal, but it ain't a big deal. It's just home. Tell you personally. Rounding the Gothic cornice, here is my bed. I spend many a lonesome night in this bed. And overlooking the bed is the Rock of Ages. We got Elvis at 19 with a stack of That's All Right Mama records that he recorded in 1954. His shirt's off and he's looking slim. He's just looking real good. It's probably the best Elvis ever looked. That's Elvis Presley right there. Then below him, we have Richie Valens, who's me and it's our band's current favorite. We got a record by him and we listen to him all the time and he's just the greatest. And before him, Buddy Holly. And God, Buddy Holly's just my tremendous idol. I don't know. I don't know him, but I love him. And below him, Gene Vincent. And there's never gonna be a wildest rocker ever again. Then Little Richard, and he ain't rocking no more, just like the rest of them aren't rocking no more. It's kind of our shrine to the rockers. And moving around. This is my first silver-tone guitar that I brought to school with me and crooned to a young lady. And it's broken now, but there's many memories in this baby. It'll be working soon. And then the coffin table, right here. This baby, this is
Big John.
We got this the night we moved into the mausoleum. But we went out in the woods and got it by the railroad tracks. And, let's see. Oh. This is what gave me the inspiration for this place. That's my father, my mother. Very nice couple. This is my Uncle Edgar. He passed away. But we're all very fond of him. Come on over here, fellas. This is our shrine. It's a soul brother number one.
Bad Man Brown.
Thanks for coming to the Moss. I'm always around, because this is a lonesome town. But then again, all towns are lonesome.
You know, the four members of R.E.M. approach their craft with a purity of vision that's really rare in the commercial jungle of the music industry.
They're remarkably free of either cliche or pretense. Now, as a musician myself, I can say there are times when we play just for the sheer fun of it. Now, R.E.M. have that spirit, so here they are enjoying what they really do best.
Rock them. Who's gonna sing? Our singer. You're gonna put a string in here. The guy in the green suit. Rolling the camera. Rolling. All right, here we go. Ready?
Rolling, yeah.
One, two, three, four. Looking at you, watch a third time, waiting in the station for the bus. Going to a place that's far, so far away, and if that's not enough, enough. Going when old body says hello, they don't talk to anybody they don't know.
We don't strive to be a band, hardly. We just kind of are here.
Inspired or you know, hit the right thing all the time, and rather than force it and really push something to try to make it, you know, a right song, you do it, and if it doesn't come out right in about 20 minutes, really, it doesn't work. I read something that Sky Saxon, the guy that was in the Seeds, said, and he said any song that takes more than 20 minutes to write is not worth writing.
We record fairly quickly, you know, we go in there and we just knock out the basic tracks on first or second take, all of them, and
no matter how bad he plays,
exactly, four mistakes, no problem, and the vocals are pretty much the same way. We even use this reference scratch vocals sometimes. It's because if you do it, the more you do it, the less spontaneous it becomes, and it sounds like you're trying real hard to get it perfect, and you spend all this time in the studio trying to get everything just right. But if you just go ahead and knock out the tracks and the vocals, which is what we do, then you can spend most of your time
playing pool,
drinking beer, remixing, you know, getting whatever overdubs you want to put on it, and doing the mix down, which is really where the important, you know, that's what it's going to sound like. That's where you get all your sound, is in the mixing. And that's where we spent, you know, 10 out of our 14 days in the studio was remixing.
Right? And I must say that I spent all of those 10 asleep, because I don't want to listen to the remixes.
Useless.
It's not my contract that I have to listen to the stuff
played
back.
You don't have a contract.
I do, too, have a contract.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I have a contract. And my contract states that I have to play the things. I don't have to listen to them.
Okay.
Somewhere down the line, you choose.
we just sit around with the guitars, usually Peter and I, and just play things until something useful comes out. If nothing useful comes out, we try it again the next night. But that's what we were doing tonight, was that's how we write songs. It's a kind of a brainstorming hit or miss process that you just play and do everything you can think of until something good comes out.
On a good night, you feel like you really can walk on water, that you can do anything, and that includes doing a brand new song that you wrote maybe at soundcheck and don't know exactly how to do it, or doing a song that the audience requests, like a cover or something, or just, you know, improvise something. We did a bit of that tonight, a bit of all of those. We did also a whole bunch of horrible stuff too. But on stage, you try not to think. You try to just, you know, let it happen. And without sounding like someone who belongs in the Grateful Dead or something, that's the way that the best music is made. I doubt Hank Williams agonized over his stuff. And Hank Williams is one of my heroes. You know, I think it just seems to me that they float out naturally. You know, and that's hopefully what we try to do, is just, you know, allow ourselves to be foolish and be stupid and sometimes be great if possible.
People, do you think are on the cutting edge?
Well, something far out, like the search for extraterrestrial intelligence or something like that. Something would have, if we found that if they did exist, would have important philosophical and scientific consequences for the world.
If they're coming up with something like cutting edge or whatever, what I would say, it would be something that shouldn't be allowed.
Cutting edge would mean cutting a piece of paper or slicing vegetables or mm-hmm. fruit. Oh, that's what I would call cutting edge. Or when you shave, mm-hmm. something about cutting the edge of your a man's shaving or whatever. Right. That's what I would terminate as cutting edge.
Brothers Dave and Phil Alvin of the Blasters have been in love with R&B, country western, and the roots of rock ever since they were in grammar school. And I suspect they'll take that love with them to their graves. Whether they're covering an obscurity from the archives of Americana or Blaster's original, it's really honest rock and roll played with feeling. And I don't think that's ever going to go out of style.
One, two, one, two, three.
A got a little mama crazy about cherry wine. I'm gonna just keep loving her. I'm gonna just
Fern Massey. You're in my home here in Downey. This is where Phil and Dave and all the fellas used to get together and practice their music before they became the Blasters.
Just keep loving, just keep loving. I just keep loving, I don't know the reason why.
Hi, I'm Phil Alvin of the Blasters, and you're here in Downey, California, in front of my house, David's house, too. It's where we lived all our lives. Downey was where the Blasters are from. This tree was planted when I was born, so I got to watch it get beat up, as long as I got beat up, too. And I'm going to take you around, show you some of the sights here in this little suburban utopia. I'm sure you'll find it much like the place that you live, too. This is Harvey's broiler. Now, I know it says Johnny's broiler. That's the only thing that's really changed, other than that nobody comes here anymore. That's what it looked like. Now, what this is where the lowriders would come. Late 50s, early 60s. Everybody go cruising on Saturdays and Friday nights. They'd come and they'd line this place like that American Graffiti movie. And I saw it, I was not that old, but I sat in the back of my cousin's car and looked down that line and be like a circus, just cars everywhere, people outside.
We had a gang of people that were all interested in playing blues and R&B and that sort of stuff. And we'd all go down like on Saturday nights with acoustic guitars and big bottles of cheap wine and sit by the riverbeds or the railroad tracks and, you know, pretend we were Hank Williams, you know. And actually, you know, to wait for the train to come by and then you'd sing, some song about a train, you know, that would like really get into it. So like that was what we were doing when we were 13 and stuff. And you wanted to go out and find, you know, Big Joe Turner or you know, Lee Allen or people like that. And they all lived in L.A., you know, and T-Bone Walker and Eddie Vincent and stuff like that. So we'd all go hang out with them and just stare at them. And they were real nice to the little white kids, you know.
This is a real national point of interest here. Just made a national monument. And those are the first golden arches. And this meat that stands before you is made up of that. I've been eating hamburgers there since before I could say the word properly. So that's them. There's a little guy up here that you don't get to see on the McDonald's things no more now that you drive through. There's this little guy that runs, and he doesn't go anywhere except up as they sell more of these hamburgers. They used to make the sign taller and taller.
He gave her his townhouse and his racing horses. Each meal she ate was a dozen courses. She had $1 million worth of niggas and dimes. And she sat around and counted them all a million times.
Jail, crowded 50 to a room. There's too many rats in this cage of the world. And the women know their place. They sit home and write letters. And then they visit once a year. When we both just sit there and stare. See how we are. We gotta keep bars in between us. See how we are. We only sing about it once in every 20 years. See how we are. Oh, see how we are. Now there are 7 kinds of coke, 500 kinds of cigarettes. This freedom of choice in the USA drives everybody crazy. While down in Acapulco, the Mexico City tourists, they don't give a shit about kids selling chiclets with no shoes on their feet. See how we are. Hey, hombre, what's in it for me? See how we are. We only sing about it once in every 20 years. See how we are. Oh, see how we are. in a night spot where beer floats in the pisser. Friend of mine said, a boy, I met a boy and I'm in love. I said, oh, really? Hey, what's his name? She said, his first name is Homeboy. I said, could his last name be Trouble? See how we are? I wouldn't trust you as far as I could throw you. See how we are? We only sing about it once in every 20 years. See how we are, oh, see how we are. Now the highway's coming through, and y'all gotta move. This bottom rung ain't no fun at all. And now fires and rock houses and grape-flavored rat poison, they are the new trinity for this so-so community. See how we are? We gotta keep bars on all our windows. See how we are? And we only sing about it once in every 20 years. See how we are, oh, see how we are.
Could be a very good movie. It would catch the ear, but right away a person would be a little fearful of the word cutting edge.
Something on the cutting edge is on, it's being examined, it's being looked at, it's mm-hmm. being taken and examined, cut apart.
Like a vivisection.
Yeah, kind of under discernment.
Like sort of like a biology sort of vivisection. Okay.
Cutting edge.
It's nice.
Yeah.
It's a nice movie, I think
so. Yes, it is nice.
Because I heard in my office mate that the movie is great.
Uh-huh. Well, I think it'd make a good title, something that's uplifting to the world, nothing to put the world down. It's bad enough the shape it's in anyway, the way it's going, but I'm saying something that'll lift people up. Well, how about the heavenly beings, or the beings from heaven, or something that's lovely.